start. President Ramnath Kovind's address to the joint sitting of Parliament set out the philosophy and priorities of the Narendra Modi government that has been re-elected. It outlined the rupture that has come to characterize Mr. Modi's politics, marked by his 2014 victory, and pointedly ignored the progress India had made during earlier years. The president said his government was committed to that very idea of nation building, the foundation for which was laid in 2014, harnessing the thoughts of social reformer Sri Narayan Guru and Rabindranath Tagore to emphasize brotherhood among all sections and the celebration of the human spirit would have been uplifting if only the rest of the speech dwelt on those ideas in some detail and with force. In the absence of elaboration, such grand intent in the initial paragraphs was not reassuring. The Prime Minister's newly aided objective of winning the trust of all governed Sabka Vishwas was not fleshed out meaningfully. Sardar Patel, Baba Saheb Ambedkar and Mahatma Gandhi found mention but not Jawaharlal Nehru. The founding Prime Minister, whose vision and unfailing commitment in secularism, pluralism and progress set the Republic on a sustainable course. The new India that the president mentioned is a departure from that founding vision, and there was no ambiguity on that aspect. He struck a chord with the constituency of the government, but not with all. The notion that there is a non-sectarian development agenda that is impervious to identity, politics is good to have, and the Prime Minister's evangelical fervor in driving its schemes is laudable. But triumphalism around many schemes, such as the Swachh Bharat Mission, has deflected public attention from the serious tasks ahead and an honest discussion on achievements. New focus on water conservation and management and the rural economy is not a moment too early. These are critical areas. Mr. Kovind also spoke of the government's intent to expand scientific research and higher education. A speech by the president is significant not for the technical details it offers, but for the vision. The cultural nationalist agenda of the ruling dispensation that has made intellectual curiosity and academic integrity dangerous in India is not the route to any of these goals. The restrictions on cattle trade and violence against those employed in it, mostly Muslims and Dalits, have not merely become a protracted communal conflict, but are also among the factors that have pushed the rural economy off the rails. Announcing yet another scheme for cattle as the president did is not confronting the real self-inflicted problem, but differentiates one dispensation from another is not the material ambitions, but the social purpose and direction of such pursuits. The clarity on that aspect in the address may be stimulating for many, but certainly not good for India. In a land where much is routine, most speeches have repeatedly quoted the strengths and provisions of the Constitution, with further mention of new government policies, important bills for social empowerment, and an assessment of natural or security challenges during that particular year. The Indian Constitution, as an essential part of its virtue, holds the president as head of state for all matters of government appointment, inaugurating parliamentary sessions, but in practice is happy to allow his or her pleasure be expressed along with that of the Prime Minister and the Council of Ministers. The President can use his or her emergency powers, which was done during the 1965 and 1971 wars, and lastly it the defamed condition of internal unrest in 1975. To most Indians, it is the last one that has become synonymous with emergency. The president would be well within his or her constitutional powers to swerve from the given format, comment on the year's performance, and set in motion a proactive theme not entirely to the liking of some, but pursuing the overall objective of an address to the nation that reflects the concerns of the common man. In the process, the president enthuses a spirit of revival and restoration of the systems of democracy as well as governance. Democracy and a nation running on principles that are just is paramount. This cannot be replaced by the promises of a growing economy. The time for that has come. The last year was a year of unprecedented scams. They included corporate bungling, an embarrassing financial audit on an international sport event, allegations of massive losses in allotment of telecom licenses, unforeseen inflation in food prices, and now an expressed disharmony in the relationships of the coalition partners. There is growing internal threat of Maoism. Finally, the winter session of Parliament went without a single working day. One would expect an appropriate note on these matters of the running of the state from a president who would soon be inaugurating the budget session of a parliament that is still in a state of stalemate. Full stop, over.